Let us continue the study of product of cell complexes. Indeed, last time we already introduced the definition, what is the meaning of locally countable. Okay, this includes locally finite also. If you countable you replace by finite, you will get locally finite condition also. All right, similar to that. So what is the condition? Every point is contained in a countable subcomplex. That subcomplex must be a neighborhood of the point in the whole space. Okay, so that is the local. Local means it should happen in a neighborhood. So that neighborhood has to come here. Okay. So if you have such a locally countable CW complex, this lemma tells you, definition was that it's locally countable if every open cell meets only countable many closed cells. Now we are putting the lemma here. Okay, so this is what happens. So justifying the definition locally countable. All right. Of course, if this happens, obviously a point will meet only finitely countably many closed cells. That will be also true. Okay. So you could have taken this as definition, but the definition is this one, namely every closed cell meets countably many closed cells, or every open cell meets countable many closed cells. Okay, every open cell meets countable many open cells is wrong, because no open cell meets any other open cell. They are disjoint. Okay, yeah. So let us prove this this lemma. First of all, each X belongs to the interior of a unique cell. So let us say interior of EM, and I will state K naught be any finite subcomplex containing EM. What you have to do? Are you sure that there is a finite subcomplex containing EM? All that you have to do now is that the closure of EM is covered by finitely many closed cells. Okay, to take the closure of all that, that will be a subcomplex, which will be finite, union of all these finitely many. Okay, you may have to start with a M cell, you may have to go down, you know, to wherever you may start, zero cells, whatever EM intersects, all those cells you may have to take. So there is a finite subcomplex because closure of EM is compact. Okay, so let us denote that by K naught. There is no uniqueness, you can choose. There is one. There is a K naught finite subcomplex containing EM. Therefore, it contains the point X also to begin with. The problem is you can't stop here because this K naught may not be an open cell. Open may not be a neighborhood of X inside capital X. Now what happens? For each closed cell EK which intersects interior of EM, you see how many of them are there? Countably many. Okay, there is a finite subcomplex that contains the closure of EK. Take any cell K, the closure of that is contained inside the finite subcomplex. Now I have to do this for countably many of them. Okay, take the union of all these finite subcomplexes to get a countable subcomplex, and that is my K1. So I repeat how I started with a point X. which is in the interior of EM, some simplex, some cell, okay, M-dimensional cell. Then I took a subcomplex which contains this EM. Okay. Now, the higher dimensional cells, their attaching maps may come inside EM, in the interior of EM. Okay. So you have to take for each such EK, take a finite subcomplex which contains that. Take the union of all these things, wherein EK ranges over all those cells whose boundary intersects EM. Call that as K1. Okay, now carry on with this procedure. What is K1? K1 is countable again. Okay, for each of the top dimensional cells in K1, you do another countable subcomplex, and union, take the union of all that, and so on, you get another larger countable subcomplex, K2, and so on. Okay, one contained in the other. What is important is K0 will be a closed subcomplex of K1, K1 will be a closed subcomplex of K2, and each of them is countable. And K0 contains our point X. Take K to be the union of KNs. Countable union of countable family, so that's also countable. It may be very huge, but it's countable. Okay? The claim is that this K contains an open subset in X, which is containing the point X. So it's a neighborhood. Okay, K is a countable subcomplex, is very clear. So to see that K is a neighborhood of X, what do we do? Start with the M cells, or started with M cell sigma, such that X is in the interior of sigma. Right? That interior, you call this as U0, an open subset inside the closed simplex. Okay, it's open in there. And actually, if it is the M-dimensional skeleton, there it will be open. The U0 is a neighborhood of X in XM, M-dimensional skeleton, and is contained in K0. K0 is by definition the finite subcomplex of some finite subcomplex which contains the cell. That's why it is K0. Okay? So you have a subcomplex K0 and this open subset inside that. Right? Now we play the old game. Let U1 be the extension of U0 to the next skeleton XM plus 1. This we know how to extend, right? From one skeleton to the next skeleton. Right? As in the proposition 2.1. So this is going to be again and again used. So I have given a lot of emphasis on this one. Then this U1 will be contained inside K1. Why? Because U1 will take only those simplexes, cells, part of those cells, which intersect the cell U0. Okay. And those things are already there inside K1. So U1 is contained inside K1, and U1 is an open subset of XM plus 1. We don't know whether it's open subset of X yet. Repeat this argument. What you will get, each time you will get a neighborhood UI, which is a neighborhood of X inside XM plus I. So U0, U1 and XM plus I, which is an extension of UI minus 1. Okay. And each UI is contained inside KI. I am just using these u naught inside Km, m means m plus 0, u1 is an extension of u naught, u1 is contained as k1. So replacing them by I. So that is the inductive step I can do. Okay. For each I greater than equal to 0, I can do this. Therefore, by theorem, earlier theorem, u, which is a union of ui's, obviously intersection with each x m plus I, it is open there, so it must be open. X belongs to that, and u will be contained inside k because ui is contained inside ki, and k is the union of all the ki's. Okay? So, many of these ideas must have been clear to you, but you must now practice yourself writing down such a proof. This proof is just balanced correctly. We can now give a number of instances when the product topology coincides with weak topology. That was our aim. Okay? Start with any two CW complexes. The product topology coincides with the CW topology on X cross Y in the following instances. This is not a if and only if theorem, mind you. X and Y are finite, then it is okay. This was the right from the beginning we knew. X is finite or Y is finite, then also it is okay. X or Y is locally compact or equivalently locally finite. X and Y have countably many cells. Both of them may be infinite. So this is something new. The last one is X and Y are both locally countable. So this is the best thing that we could say so far. You will see that you might, this is not true. We will have a counterexample also. Okay. But there may be other directions wherein you can try to do that thing. But if X and Y are both of them are locally countable, even if one of them is not locally countable. Okay. A particular case may be there, but we will give a counterexample. Counterexample doesn't mean that there are one for some cases. For everything, that is not true. It is not an if and only theorem. Okay. Yeah. One, two and three, they are already seen. How? One we have seen, X or Y is finite also we can see, because if Y is finite, it's compact, this will be always compactly generated. Compactly generated and compact product, we know it's compactly generated. Similarly, X or Y is locally compact, one of them is locally compact, another is compactly generated, this also we have seen earlier. Okay, all the three of them we have seen earlier. The first thing which we have not yet seen is X and Y have countably many cells. And X and Y are locally countable. These two things could not have been seen earlier. This is a special case for CW complexes. Okay, so 4 and 5 needs to be proved. Okay, to prove 4, so let W be an open subset of this CW complex product. Take a point X naught Y naught inside W. You should produce a neighborhood U of X naught and a neighborhood V of Y naught such that U cross V is contained inside W. If you have done this for every point, that would mean that X cross this W is now open in X cross Y. Okay, that is the product topology. What we have started is W is open inside the CW topology here. Okay. So how do you use the hypothesis in four? Evanescence says X and Y are countably many cells. This is what you have to use. So write X as union of KNs and Y as union of LNs. What are KN and LN? They are increasing union. Actually, one question, but they are finite subcomplexes now. I can't take skeletons and so on now. A countable complex can always be written as union of finite complexes, subcomplexes. How you enumerate all the cells. Okay. Take the first cell. It may not be a subcomplex, but it is contained in a finite subcomplex. So take that as K naught. Now put second one. The union K naught and the second one must be contained in another finite subcomplex. Okay, like this Ki you have constructed. Take the I plus one cell which you have enumerated. Put that one also together. That may not be a subcomplex, but that will be contained in a larger subcomplex which is finite, and so on. Okay, so you can always write a countable complex as a increasing union of finite subcomplexes. So write it, write them like that. Okay, and assume that X naught and Y naught are in the first one, namely K naught and L naught. The CW topology on X and similarly CW topology on Y, you can just go to these KNs. Okay. Actually, if you take KN as such, then it's similar to our earlier argument. If you take the induced topology, co-induced topology with respect to this family KN, it will be finer than the compactly generated thing. But then each KN is again contained in a finitely many, covered by finitely many compact things. Therefore, it is equal. Okay. The first thing to note that CW topology on X, similarly on Y, is equal to the co-induced topology by these families. Therefore, to say something is open or closed inside X, I can intersect it with KN and see that whether it is open or closed inside KN. Since KN and LN are compact, if you just take KN cross LN and the topology and the CW topology on that, it is the same thing as KN cross LN by the first case. Therefore, if you take W intersection KN cross LN, okay, this is a neighborhood of X naught Y naught in KN cross LN. Why? Because if I put a W here, it is a neighborhood. But they are the same here, so it is a neighborhood of KN cross LN. Now this KN cross LN in the standard product topology. Since W is a neighborhood of X inside K, inside X cross Y with the usual topology, with the CW topology, W intersection KN cross LN must be a neighborhood inside KN cross LN W, but I don't have to write W. That's all I am telling you. Okay. Inductively, we shall construct sets U and V n inside KN and LN such that UN intersection KN minus 1 is UN minus 1, VN intersection LN minus 1 is VN minus 1. And our starting point X naught Y naught is in each of the U and V n contained in W intersection KN cross LN. Okay. Then we put U equal to UN, V equal to VN, and as before, we can appeal to theorem 2.3 to conclude that U and V are open subsets of X and Y respectively. So this inductive step has to be done again. Okay. For this, we have to use one more small topology. So first of all, we shall construct U and Vn with an additional property, which is stronger property, and that will help us to carry out the inductive property, carry out the inductive step. What is the additional property? We'll do that. Let's say Un bar and Vn bar are compact. So we are in the construction, we are going to make such a each Un and Vn, okay, such that their closures are compact. So these U and Vn are compact neighborhoods. Okay. And Un bar, Vn bar itself doesn't go out of W intersecting K and W. So that we keep extending them. Okay. So this is a clever way of trying to do the extension. If you try to do extension, you will see that you better assume this one. So that means in the earlier you have to have constructed it in that way. Otherwise you can't assume that, right? Okay. So when n equal to 0, what is it? U naught, V naught. Where are they? They must be inside K naught and L naught, right? X naught, Y naught belongs to U naught, V naught. U naught, V naught bar contains U naught, V naught. U naught bar cross V naught bar in W intersection K naught, such that U naught bar, V naught bar is compact. Why you can do this? Where are the X naught and Y naught? They will be in some cells, right? They will be interior of some cell, right? That cell is an open set. Its closure is compact, right? So this is happening inside K naught and L naught are both compact subsets. I mean, finite CW complexes. So that's why this is possible. In other words, all that I am telling you here is that a compact Hausdorff space is locally compact also. Therefore, I can do that X naught belongs to U naught, U naught bar is compact, contained inside W intersecting K naught. Remember, this W intersecting K naught, L naught, we have already noticed, we have just first noticed that it is open neighborhood of X naught, Y naught and Kn cross Ln for each n. So I'm using that here. The first thing is they are compact subsets, so I can choose this one to be compact subset. Construction for n equal to 0 is over. Now assume this is done for nth stage, okay, satisfying these two conditions. Okay, then using compactness of Un bar and Vn bar, you can now find open sets, say Un prime and Vn prime, in Kn plus 1, Ln plus 1, such that Un prime is contained in the Un plus 1 prime, Vn prime contains Vn plus 1 prime, the closures of product is inside W intersection Kn plus 1. So this is a version of Wallman's theorem for compact subsets. I have stated it in exercise. Okay. I will just tell you what is this exercise. It's there below. Suppose you have a neighborhood of K cross L, where K and L are compact subsets inside X cross Y. Okay. Then you can get a U and a V inside X and Y, so said K is contained inside U, L is contained inside V, U cross V itself is contained in the given neighborhood W. I repeat, suppose you start with a product space XY, arbitrary product spaces, okay? You can assume they are Hausdorff spaces, whatever. K and L are subsets, compact subsets. K cross L is contained in an open set. Then you can choose open subsets UV containing K and L respectively, such that U cross V itself is contained inside the given open set. Okay, so this is what we are going to use. This is what we have used here. Un prime, Un plus 1 prime, and Vn plus 1 prime will be in Kn L plus N cross L plus. Okay, now use 2.1 repeatedly if needed. You can extend U and Vn to open subsets Un plus 1, Vn plus 1 in Kn plus 1 and Ln plus 1 respectively, such that Un plus 1 bar is inside Un plus 1 prime. Okay, the bar of the extended thing is inside this one, and Vn plus 1 bar is in Vn plus 1 prime. The point here is, in choosing this one, Un plus 1 bar prime intersection with Kn may not be equal to Un. But now we can make that. So this was the gist of this proposition, right? We can extend that. Extension means intersection with this one must be the given open set. Okay, so here Un prime and Vn prime, they are some arbitrary open subsets larger than the original ones. But when you intersect with the old one, okay, say Un prime intersect with Kn may not be equal to Vn prime, it may be larger. That will cause problem. So this extension, when you say, it's precisely equal to. Okay, and that is needed in the final conclusion. Once you have that, your problem is over. So what we have done, I will just recall, what we have done is that if you have countable, both this one, fourth one, both X and Y are countably many cells, then the product topology coincides with the CW topology. The fifth one is easier if you use the fourth one now. Okay. So given a point x naught y naught in x cross y, by the previous lemma, the lemma which we started with today, there are countable subcomplexes k comma l respectively in x and y, right? And K and L are neighborhoods of X naught and Y naught in X and Y respectively. So fix X naught belonging to A contained inside K, Y naught belonging to B contained inside Y, such that A and B are open sets. So that is possible because they are neighborhoods. Okay. Now, essentially, what we have we are trying to do is to reduce this problem, problem 5 to problem 4. Both of them are countable case. Okay. Now let W be, yet we don't have that picture yet, because the whole thing has to be inside X cross Y, right? Not that K and L, that is fine, but you have to prove that this is finally the neighborhood is in X cross Y, right? So you have to prove. Let W be open in X cross Y, the CW topology, and take X naught belong to W. Okay, then W intersection K cross L W, this will be open in K cross L W, but this is equal to L by 4. That is the point. Therefore, there are open sets as U in K and V in L such that U cross V inside W. But then A intersection U is open inside U. Okay. Therefore, open inside X. See, A and B are open inside. You have got A here inside K and B inside Y. They are open subsets. Okay. Because K and L should be L. K and L are countable subcomplexes which are neighborhoods. Okay. Therefore, A intersection U is open in U, therefore open in X. Similarly, B intersection V is open in B, so it is open in Y. Therefore, X naught Y naught, which belongs to A cross U, A intersection U cross B intersection V, that will be inside W. Okay, so 4 actually helps to solve this problem. Here is an example due to Dawker, which tells you that if both X and Y are not locally countable, then the product topology need not coincide with the CW topology. Okay, so for this, we start with the following notation. Let this N denote the set of natural numbers and L denote the set of all functions phi from N to N. Consider the real vector space R power N, which is the direct sum of copies of R, as many copies as natural numbers. And R power L, the direct sum of copies of R, as many as capital, this curly L, namely indexed by functions from end to end. Both of them, you give the compactly generated topology. Okay. So that we are now going to construct a subspace of this R power N, that will be called X, and another subspace of R power L, that will be subset of Y. Automatically, they will be having compactly generated topology, and they will be just one-dimensional CW complexes. When we take the product of X with Y, the product topology will not coincide with the CW topology. So that is the idea. Okay, so let us choose these standard basis elements for R capital N and R curly N, namely V N and U phi, indexed by N be the natural number and phi is functions on the natural numbers to natural numbers. Now put X equal to all the line segments emanating from 0 and ending at the endpoint Vn. So you can write them as R times Vn, where R is real number between 0 and 1. So look at all of them. They will be all be incident at the origin of R power N. Okay. And the endpoint will be the vector Vn. Okay, you look at this complex. This is a one-dimensional complex. Okay, consisting of just edges, all of them having single point common and indexed by these vectors Vn themselves. So of course, R and W indicate the weak topology, the topology generated by finite subspaces, which is the same thing as compactly generated topology. Similarly, Y will be R, U, phi. Phi is inside capital L and 0 less than R less than or to N. So it's exactly similar, only the number of edges here will be very huge. Then both X and Y are CW complexes, which are one dimensional. Okay, and you can think of them as one point union of number of edges. Okay, so the claim is, as told you, the CW topology on X cross Y is strictly finer than the product topology. So in order to do that, what we are going to do is we will display a subset which is discrete inside the CW topology, but it will have the zero as a limit point, the zero means the origin as a limit point in the broader topology. So that space is precisely this P consisting of points P, N, comma phi, indexed by N as well as phi. What are they? The first coordinate is Vn divided by phi N. Second coordinate is U phi divided by phi N. Phi N and, you know, for all N, phi N is some natural number. So I can divide out by that. So this will be one of the points on the edge, cross edge. Okay, so this will be one of the points in the two-dimensional cell, one cell here cross the other cell here. Okay, as you take N and phi different, okay, N prime and phi prime, that will be in a different two cell. So all these points are interior inside exactly one cell. Each point belongs to the interior of exactly one two-dimensional cell, 0, comma Vn cross 0, comma U phi. Okay, therefore, by our old lemma, the set P is a discrete closed subset of the topology, namely the CW topology. However, all that we have to show is now the origin 0 in Rn cross Rl is in the closure of P in the product topology. What is the meaning of that? Take any open subset around 0, show that it intersects P. Okay, so an open subset around 0 will consist in the product topology, consist of a smaller open subset of the form U cross V, where U is a neighborhood of 0 in Rn and V is a neighborhood of 0 in Rl. Okay, once you have such a thing, automatically for each N and phi, for each line segments emanating from 0, we will have some Rn such that, and Rn and S phi numbers depending upon N and phi, such that the entire line segment lambda times Vn, where lambda varies from 0 to Rn, is contained inside you. Similarly, here lambda ring from 0 to S phi, lambda times U phi, that will be contained inside V. This will be true for every N and every phi. Okay. Therefore, now I would like to give you a sequence of points which converge to the origin. So consider psi from N to N given by psi N equal to maximum of N, or look at 1 by Rn, take its integral part of 1 by Rn. So these two are some natural numbers now. Okay, add one more. Take the maximum and add one more. That is my psi n. Then psi n will tend to infinity as n tends to infinity because this is bigger than n. Hence, we can choose little m such that this psi m is bigger than any number 1 by s psi. Okay. 1 by Rn is there. So integral part of that plus 1 is bigger than that one. So choose psi m bigger than 1 by f psi. Automatically this one. It follows that 1 by psi m into v psi m, 1 by psi into u psi, this will be inside P as well as inside U cross V, because this number, whatever you have taken, should be less than Rn. And that second part should be less than S psi. So that is what, if you take psi m like this, 1 by psi will be less than S psi here. Okay. So that completes the proof of the counterexample. Thank you.